Good Friday morning. I hope you're having a fantastic start to your day with your Celebration Radio Network on this 18th day of September. And Pastor Ryan Speakman, best-selling author, videographer, and professor of the end times.
Really good-looking guy, very charming, yeah, et cetera, et cetera.
You know, I tell you, every time, that's your wife's job.
I know. I'm filming for her.
I might not ever say that you're a good-looking guy, just to let you know.
Yeah, come on.
I mean, you are, you and I both. You know, anyway.
Well, my wife's not here, so I'm going to say what I know she would say it if she was here. So.
Well, I hope she says it.
Yes, but I appreciate the kind words and super happy to be with radio host extraordinaire Bill Casputis the second. I still don't know if I'm pronouncing your last name.
It's Casputis.
Casputis. So I was pretty close.
K-A-S. So yeah. Cas.
Is that Russian, or I've asked you this before?
It's, you know, I want to say like Lithuanian.
Yeah, yeah.
That's Hungarian kind of.
It's supposed to sound like Latvian or something.
It's not actually my nationality, though.
Okay.
Because it's my dad's adopted last name.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Yeah. His last name was Benetham, which is English.
Oh, okay. So, which is what I am. I'm like 99% British based on DNA tests. So,
yeah, I haven't done the DNA test. My Aunt Nancy did it, and come to find out, we actually had Irish and all kinds of other things in there. Makes it that I had no idea that I was part Irish.
Oh, yeah. I've got a little bit of that. You know, yeah. I mean, Irish, Welsh, all that. So
the luck of the morning to you.
Yeah.
Know, that kind of, I don't, so I Bill didn't and know I had
the,
any of that.
Bill and I are officially the two whitest guys on the radio. Right. Yeah. British Isles from the Empire.
But I do have Cherokee Indian.
Uh-huh.
And I'm from my dad's side. So.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah.
Yeah.
There was a rumor in my family. I know we're not even talking about our topic yet, but.
Oh, no,
there was,
not even close.
It's early. There was a rumor in my family the whole time I was growing up. My you know, parents would tell us, you know, you're at least half Cherokee, maybe even two-thirds Cherokee or something like that. A third to two-thirds, that range. And I actually have family that's on the reservation, Illinois Station Cherokee Nation in Oklahoma. There was a relative named Grace Ann McGee who wrote a book in the early part of the 20th century. And I've actually got a copy of the book, you know, on my bookshelf in my office. It's called From the Trail of Tears to Millionaire.
Oh, wow.
And it's the story of how one of our ancestors was on the Trail of Tears, and he didn't actually become a millionaire, but that was his promise to this Cherokee woman that he wanted to marry, and she ended up marrying him, right? Ready for the funny thing, though? So half of the family completely believed the story. The other half didn't believe it. They said, this isn't true. She's making it up. And what the story was that Grace Ann McGee, I don't know why I'm telling the story on the radio. Great, because it's entertaining. Grace Ann McGee was, as it turns out, was actually a caregiver. I hope my parents aren't listening. They still believe the Cherokee story. Was actually a caregiver for a Cherokee woman, an elderly Cherokee woman who had been on the trail. It was actually her story. And so my identical twin brother, so he and I had the same DNA, identical twins. We just had a birthday, by the way, on Saturday.
I know,
went out there and spent the weekend with him.
Birthday.
So now we're old like you. No, yeah, we're 53, yes, so yeah, 53, these days.
Almost,
yeah, wonderful.
Almost middle-aged.
Yeah. So Aaron had a DNA test done, and like I say, we're like 99% British. No Cherokee showed up, so I think the Grace Ann just borrowed someone else's story. But, yeah.
Who knows?
Who knows? Who knows? You know what? We're
maybe that DNA thing really doesn't work.
You know, and the Bible says that we're actually grafted into the nation of Israel. So you and I are actually Jews.
I'm part Jewish.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, genetically, maybe not for me, but you know, for sure we're grafted in. So I'm
spiritually, definitely.
Spiritually we are, and we're part of the body of Christ. How did Paul say? We're not citizens of this world, but we're citizens of a greater kingdom.
Yeah.
So that's, you know, as Christians, we'll just keep our identity in that. Keep it all simple. Don't need a DNA test for that, right?
Nope.
So good morning. Happy to be here. So our show, we call it, what do we call it again?
The Coming Kingdom with Bill and Ryan.
Yep. So, and our topic is...
Oh, well, the Coming Kingdom.
Yes. So, we call it the end times, but I like our title better, the Coming Kingdom, because our emphasis here is not on the sensationalist stuff, the doom and gloom, the world's going to come to an end. I mean, the world system's going to come to an end, but the world's not going to come to an end. Jesus is going to come back in his physical body not as a baby this time, but as a mighty king.
Right.
To sit in the rebuilt temple on the Temple Mount in Jerusalem and rule and reign, usher in God's full manifest kingdom in this world, which it isn't right now. I mean, Paul calls Satan the god of this world. Yeah, Satan is the god of this world, right?
Yep.
So we want to see that change.
Right now,
so
but
right
that
now
is going to change.
It's changing soon. I both believe very much in our lifetime this is going to happen. So we talk about the events and conditions that will lead up to Jesus' return, and the Bible from Genesis to Revelation goes into great detail about that. So God wants us to know, hey, you know, this is going to happen. There's going to be wars and rumors of wars. There's going to be famines, pestilences. We're in a big one right now. A very historical one for a lot of reasons. Earthquakes in diverse places, and then even worse than that, something called the Great Tribulation will begin, and you know, great turmoil on the earth, like the earth has never seen. Jesus himself in Matthew chapter 24, the Olivet Discourse, he says, those days are so bad that unless those days are shortened, no flesh would even be saved.
Yeah.
But for the elect's sake, those days will be shortened. I think that's Matthew 24, verses 21 and 22, if I remember correctly. Somewhere in there he says that. So we know that some bad times are coming. There's a person that we know as the Antichrist, that we call the Antichrist, worst, you know, human being, if we can even call him that, that's ever existed. He's going to do some very, very bad things. So, you know, God wants us as his people to know about all this stuff so that we're prepared in advance. I forget the scripture references of John 16:33. Jesus says, see, I've told you all these things beforehand, so help me out here, so that you will have hope and not be afraid.
Yeah.
Right.
Right.
Because I have overcome the world. I completely paraphrase that. But the point is that there's a reason that God tells us in his word why all these things will happen, so that when they do happen, we know what's going on.
Right.
We know that it's a sign of the times, and it's a sign that Jesus is coming back soon. So
yeah, because after that, he says, look up, for your redemption draweth nigh.
Yeah, that's Luke chapter 21.
So.
Yes. Exactly. Yeah. So we're waiting for that. And so that's our focus here. It's not the end, but it's the end of this world system. And it's the beginning of what God really intended
world. I want to clarify something, though. You said this world, you know, is not going to pass away. I think that's what you said. But the Bible does tell us that there is going to be a new earth.
Okay. That's very good point.
New Jerusalem, and, you know, new heaven, everything.
New earth, new Jerusalem. Yeah.
I mean, Revelation it's chapter 21. Completely destroyed.
Yes.
And then God is just going to recreate it.
But that's way down the road. We don't
it is.
About
that's
that.
After yeah. the thousand
and that's,
years.
And that's actually not, that's not even a bad thing, you know, there. In fact,
No. We want that.
Yeah, exactly. So, you know, when we talk about, you know, like the Great Tribulation that will precede Jesus' second coming, that's bad stuff. That's a time of extreme, you know, tribulation, turmoil, trials, persecution. A lot of Christians will be killed during that time by the Antichrist and his minions. A lot of Jews will be killed during that time. But then, Jesus will rule and reign for 1,000 years in this world as it is.
Right, exactly.
And
that's what I wanted to clarify.
Yeah, no, it's a good point, Bill. Yeah, that's why we make such a great team, right? Back me up here.
Yes.
So you and I during that time will be in our glorified bodies.
Yeah.
So whether believers are resurrected from the dead, they get a glorified body, or raptured, you know, those of us who are alive and remain when Jesus comes back, will be in immortal bodies ruling and reigning with Jesus in this realm as it is now, as kings
years.
And priests.
Yeah.
But then, you're exactly right. At the end of that time,
that's when Lucifer gets loosed, the dragon, you know, he gets loosed again, but then the ultimate battle with him and Jesus take place, and then he's cast in the lake
Gog
of fire forever.
Exactly.
I mean, there is no redemption at all for anybody.
Yep.
After that point, it's over. You might as well just, you know.
Yeah. And then God says, okay, you know, we're past this whole story now. Yep. Jesus has had the millennial reign. So now let's create this whole brand new, amazing.
Yeah. That's going to be fun.
Probably, you know, new dimensions will unfold. I mean, we get into like the, you know, physics of it. The Bible actually kind of gets into that, you know. But there will be a new heaven, new earth, new Jerusalem. Again, way down the road. That's going to be amazing.
Yeah, picture that. 1,500 miles wide, 1,500 miles
city.
High.
Yeah.
I mean, right now, the space station is about 120 miles above us.
Oh, okay, right.
So 1,500 miles?
Yeah.
I mean, that's, you know, the moon is 244,000 miles away from the Earth.
Yeah.
So, you know, we look up at the moon and how big that is.
Yeah.
And it's 244,000
miles
away.
Yeah, very good.
You imagine being in the new city of Jerusalem and going to the top floor, you know, 1,500 miles.
This is what I mean about when God does this. And this is, you know, Revelation chapter 21 and chapter 22.
Yeah, there's no oxygen right now up there.
Right.
You know, at 100 miles up, you can't breathe.
Oh, yeah, exactly.
You know, you get up about 80,000 feet and you're struggling to breathe.
I was going to say 10 miles up and yeah, you can barely breathe. But so it kind of implies
that
the new heaven, new earth, new
Jerusalem.
Yeah, that God's going to actually, you know, reinvent the physics of our universe. Yeah. Again, maybe the concept of like dimension, you know, additional dimensions unfolding. Mm-hmm. Great book by a very, very famous astrophysicist, Martin Rees, back in the early 1990s, called Before the Beginning. And that actually talks about that, how our universe has a certain number of dimensions. There are four that have unfolded. There's 11 total, but seven are still kind of like coiled up and they haven't actually unfolded yet. So I actually have a theory that the new heaven, new earth, new Jerusalem, that's actually God saying, okay, now we're going to unfold all the potential dimensions that he created at the very beginning.
How cool is that?
This is actually a secular scientist saying this, right? Yeah, yeah. It's amazing stuff. But yeah, it's a physical reality. Okay.
Yeah, we gotta go.
I just realized,
break.
Man, we get on a roll. Anyways,
I know, it's so easy.
Too much fun.
Yeah, it is. But the phone number, 800-721-9313, 800-721-9313, if you'd like to ask us a question. We will also be doing a contest today. We'll tell you about that coming up in the next hour as well. Also, there's something behind me on the shelf that we're going to talk
about. Don't let me forget about that.
No,
yeah.
We will not forget about that.
Now, this is so me, but I brought in show and tell for radio.
But
we're
going to
take a picture. We're going to put it online. Yeah. So you'll see what we're,
And we're going to talk about what's in that coming up here in just a few minutes from now. Also, we're going to finish the story of two scientists that we're trying to get together.
Yes.
With our the fundraiser that's on your page.
Yes.
Your website at thesefinaldays.org. If
the
you haven't
incense
checked
fundraiser,
it out yet,
it's called. Right.
Please do so. Coming up in just a few minutes, we're going to talk about, what we just said we're going
all
to talk
kinds
about.
Of stuff.
Yeah, there's, and plus it's Rosh Hashanah.
Rosh Hashanah starts tonight. Got to talk about that.
The treaty with Bahrain.
Yeah.
I mean, there is so much to unpack.
I should have come in earlier today. Oh, well.
Well, we would only had like five more minutes.
So. Yeah, we'll do what we can.
Yeah.
You know, I just wanted Ryan to know that I really enjoy, I missed him the last couple of weeks, and I really enjoy you two together, and it's the kind of thing that I study for years now, and I really enjoy it. Thank you so much for the time he spends there and sharing with us.
Well, he is in front of the microphone
right
now.
Yeah, thank you. I appreciate that. Yeah, yeah.
Ryan, I really do enjoy you. As a matter of fact, like I say, I've been studying that kind of thing for quite a while now, and
good.
I would love to have some of your DVD teaching.
Yeah. So who am I speaking to? What's your
name? This is Rick in Truth or Consequences.
Oh, Rick. Okay. No, this isn't the Rick, the one that
not Rick from Laughlin.
So this Truth or Consequences.
Yeah,
okay.
Rick from Truth or Consequences.
Yeah. So
we have different accents.
Yeah. Okay. Right. Yeah. You didn't sound like the Rick, but I'm just making sure. So. But so if you go to my website, thesefinaldays.org, you can find my book series there. I've got part one and part two published. I'm very close to publishing part three. It'll be a five-part series by the time I'm done. You can also find a link to my Facebook page on there. And every Thursday, 6 o'clock Arizona time, I teach a live class for my church here in Havasu, and you can actually go online and join us and like make comments and ask questions. And then finally, you'll find a link on my website. Again, it's thesefinaldays.org to my YouTube channel. And on YouTube, you can find my teachings, my documentaries about Israel. I've been over there three times. I've done all kinds of little, all kinds of, interviews, things
actually,
like that.
Actually, I'm aware of that. Like I said, I've been listening to you for a while. Now, here's the fun thing. I have a computer that I bought about 4 or 5 years ago, still in the box. I have a hotspot still in the box.
Wow.
And I have a flip phone. I really like not being part of that internet propaganda that's out there. Not that yours is, but
I understand. Oh boy, I understand what you're saying.
And so, because I can't listen to the news, I can't listen to the media. I do it with a grain of salt.
Yeah,
and
good.
As it would say in scripture, I'm gleaning for myself.
Good,
and
that's wisdom.
So I have like over 20 translations and study Bibles as well. I have the King James, and I have Antiquities of the Jews.
Oh, great one, Josephus.
And I have it in Aramaic, and I have it in Hebrew, and I have it in Greek. And I study all three.
Oh, fantastic,
In other words, I'm thirsting for it. I want the truth. I don't want what the world is trying to teach me.
Yeah.
And I'm studying for myself.
That's awesome.
Like it says in Hebrew, you know, I don't want to be nursed. You know, he who uses milk is unskillful in the word of righteousness.
Right.
For he is a babe. I'm studying it for myself.
We should be on meat. Yeah.
And my wisdom is worthless. I wait for guidance.
Yeah. Wow. Excellent.
Thanks, Rick.
Gentlemen, have a great day.
Yeah, God bless you, brother. Good to talk to you.
Yeah, I love you, brother.
God bless you as well.
We'll talk to you soon. Bye-bye. 1-800-721-9313. Good morning, your Celebration Radio Network.
Hello, Mr. Bill.
Hello.
Oh, Sharon Jackson. I know that voice. How are you?
I am fine. I have a question.
Okay.
During the thousand-year millennial reign,
mm-hmm.
do you believe that that will be a time without any kind of influence from Satan, that people such as Jews and Gentiles will understand and receive Jesus as their Lord and Savior, or utilize their will of choice and neglect him or reject him? That's my question.
Good question, Sharon, of course.
Well, I think, you know, because there's so many people uncertain or confused because of all that is going on. And so that's why I said that.
Mm-hmm,
and
yeah.
Thank you for addressing the fear factor, too, because so many hear of all this doom and gloom, and they become frightened, and they forget that, you know, if you hang on to God's strong right hand, you've got it.
Yeah. This is the test. When Jesus comes back, will he find faith in the world? And that's the measure right there.
Yep.
So
I'll keep praying for you too.
Yeah, love you. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you. God bless you.
Give a big hug to Kurt. Tell him it's for me.
I
love you guys.
Okay.
Thanks.
God bless.
800-721-9313, 18 minutes to the top of the hour on your Celebration Radio Network. And just had a couple of great calls, one from Rick in Truth or Consequences, New Mexico, and one from Sharon,
mm-hmm.
One of your classmates.
Does that work? Participants in my class.
Yeah, her,
exactly.
Her husband, Kurt.
Yeah. So. Iron sharpens iron. Yes.
Yeah. And so. She had a great question for us, and we'll get to that. Coming up. So,
why don't we just, I told her we'd answer a question, briefly.
All right. Well, she asked us if I got this right, is the devil going to, during the thousand years reign of Christ on the earth,
mm-hmm.
In the temple, will Satan still have influence over those that are alive? And also, she asked if people were going to be able to give their lives to the Lord during mm-hmm. that thousand years.
So your thoughts on this, Bill?
Well, Scripture tells us that he's going to be bound for that thousand years.
Mm-hmm.
So he's not going to be able to do anything.
Right.
He's loosed after that, and for a short time.
At the very end.
But not during that thousand years.
Yeah, at the very end of the thousand years.
Yeah,
so maybe
he'll be released.
Maybe for a year or so at the end or something.
I mean, we don't know what the time frame is. We have no idea what God has in mind
for that. It doesn't say exactly.
Yeah, it doesn't say. So but he's going to be bound up, changing at the bottom. In the pit, not
the abyss.
Hell.
Yeah,
kind of thing.
It's called the bottomless pit.
Two separate places. So
right.
For the thousand years, he will be in a pit, and then after that, that's when he goes to the lake of fire for eternity kind of thing.
Exactly. After that. So, very, very good. So, Jesus comes back at the end of the seven-year Great Tribulation. At that moment when Jesus comes back, that's what we call the Battle of Armageddon. It's really the final battle of what I call the War of Armageddon, because it goes on for, a little bit of time. And then the Antichrist and the false prophet immediately get thrown into the lake of fire. They're the first two people, quote unquote, to be thrown in the lake of fire. They're by themselves down there for a thousand years. No one else is thrown in.
Right.
And like you just said, Satan doesn't even get put in the lake of fire.
Right.
He's just bound up for... Now, here's what's interesting, though, is that the Bible tells us, Revelation chapter 20, and also we read about this at the end of the book of Ezekiel.
Yeah, it's something about influencing kings, or
to kind of try to directly answer Sharon's question, I think the answer to me is clearly no, that Satan is not influencing any humans during that time.
Right.
But this is what's interesting. Nevertheless, there's this another world war that breaks out at the end of the millennial reign. It's called the Gog-Magog War. So it's actually Gog, the Prince of Magog, which is the ancient name of Russia. Okay, so Russia right now is a major belligerent in the end times war, which we're in right now, right? And apparently that spirit will continue even throughout the millennial reign. So and then the Bible also talks, this is so weird, most people don't know this, very surprising, but it also talks about that the people will be, that the unrighteous will be kept out of the holy city during the millennial reign. So there is still unrighteousness happening on earth, even without the influence of Satan. Very important question, Sharon. I'm glad you asked this. It says in Zechariah chapter 14, if I remember correctly, that that all nations will celebrate Sukkot. That's the holiday that's coming up 2 weeks from today. Okay, we're going to talk about that at some point. They come up every year to celebrate Sukkot in Jerusalem during the millennial reign, and those nations that don't come up experience drought in their land. So there's entire nations, apparently, that are going to be rebelling against Jesus during the millennial reign without any influence from Satan, which tells us something we really need to know as humans. We don't need Satan to sin. What was the old show? Was it Laughing? Where Flip Wilson, that funny line, "The devil made me do it."
Yeah.
You and I are just old enough to remember that. We were like little kids at the time.
Yeah,
but
real little.
Right. When Satan tempted Adam and Eve in the garden, he didn't cause them to sin. Right. All he did is tap into the sin, potential for sin that was already in them, because that's how God creates free will beings. If we have a free will, that means we have the free will to rebel against him. You know, Satan himself did it in heaven.
Yeah,
before, working with God, you know, at God's right hand, and you know, so
yeah,
so yeah, good question. Something really weird that's kind of getting slightly, but it is on topic. You know, Sharon's question. Do you know that in Revelation chapter 21 and 22, 21, it even says that this is so weird, Bill, that even during the new heaven, new earth, and new Jerusalem, after this world has passed away, God's created a new one, it talks about the new Jerusalem. You were describing the dimensions of it, how it's, you know, unimaginably huge, and it's not a two-dimensional city like today we would describe Havasu, you know, in terms of width and length, but not height.
Right.
But the new Jerusalem is just, you know, so again, new physics. It says that the unrighteous will not be allowed to enter the city. So does that mean that even in the new heaven, new earth, and new Jerusalem, that there's still sin going on? Apparently. Well, I mean, look it up, Revelation chapter 21. So maybe this whole story of like good versus evil, evil again is just a byproduct of the fact that God creates those who he loves with a free will. And it could just be that, you know, that this story, good versus evil, maybe continues for eternity. Boy, what a downer to say that. But, you know, because we like to imagine, no, you know, we'll all be perfect and righteous and there'll be, you know, no more sin or whatever. I think for a lot of us, that will be 100% true. Those of us who have found Christ and are in him and remain in him. But it, you know, I mean, let's, you know, like Rick was saying on the call when he called in, you know, we need to get off the milk and start eating meat.
Yeah.
And if the meat sometimes is hard to swallow, we still need to eat it.
Chew it longer.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. Got to get that protein. So, boy, Sharon, you opened up a can of worms for us. Thank you.
Yes, thank you. Yeah. I love in-depth questions like that.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. Okay, so getting back to what we were talking about before, Rosh Hashanah starts tonight.
Yes.
We've got Sukkot coming up. We have the 10 days of...
Well, so how it works on the on the Jewish calendar is that the first day of the month of Tishri on the Jewish calendar, the Hebrew calendar, the first day of Tishri is Rosh Hashanah. Okay, that's today.
Tonight,
okay, that begins at sunset today, right,
around
this evening.
6 o'clock or whatever.
Right, whenever the sun sets, it's, you know. And what this marks is the beginning of the Jewish civil year, okay, because the Jews actually, this, you know, this is why I love all this stuff, because it's so complicated. They actually have 4 different years that they have to keep track of. 2 main ones. There's the civil year that begins today, Rosh Hashanah, and then there's what's called the ecclesiastical year that begins 6 months from now on Nisan 1. Okay, that's now the ecclesiastical year that begins on Nisan 1, and these are both biblical. These are both you know, new years that God ordained in the Torah, right? So the ecclesiastical year is for keeping track of specifically the major festivals, the Shalosh Regalim, right? Mm-hmm. So that's Pesach, Shavuot, so, you know, we know it's Passover and Pentecost, and then Sukkot, the one coming up in a couple of weeks, right? And also in ancient times, you know, during the time of the kings, it was to keep track of when kings would rule. So a king's rule would typically begin on Nisan 1. But the civil year, this is actually very pertinent, okay? This isn't just information for information's sake. The civil year, which begins today, is specifically for the purpose of legal contracts, okay? So this is interesting because...
So like Jubilee and things like that.
Jubilee is actually considered the third year that they keep track of.
50-year celebration or 50 days or...
It's 50 years. It's 50 years, right? Every 50 years, there's a Jubilee. Exactly. Debts are forgiven, things like that. And then there's also the sabbatical year, which comes up, which is like the Sabbath. So that's every seventh year the Jews
For the land, though, wasn't it?
Yes, they were supposed to give the land a rest and not you know, plant anything, just give
or
the...
Or harvest, yeah.
And then there were other things that went along. Yep. Here's what's pertinent about Rosh Hashanah, though, being the it means the head of the year, Rosh Hashanah, about it being, you know, the year where contracts are, or the day when contracts are made, major contracts or covenants or treaties.
I was going to say, that's
you see what I'm getting
cool
at here, yeah.
Considering what happened with Bahrain yesterday.
So. It was this week.
Yeah.
So what's, you go ahead and you brought it up.
I mean, the treaty that President Trump and his team and everyone has been working towards, this is the second, you know, he had the Emirates,
United Arab Emirates.
Yeah, so it's United UAE. Arab Emirates. Yep. Just a couple weeks ago, and then a month ago or whatever it was.
It was a few weeks ago.
And then we have Bahrain, which happened yesterday, I believe.
I think it was on Tuesday, a few days ago. It was this week, right? Yeah. Well, here's what's interesting is that the UAE actually didn't sign a treaty until this week. So they signed it
at the same time that Bahrain did.
Yeah. And it's just within a few days of Rosh Hashanah. So the reason that's interesting, is, and I've had people ask me, hey, is this the treaty, the one from Daniel 9:27?
No, unfortunately, but it's a precursor to it.
Yeah, that's exactly the right answer. So why would you say no, this isn't it? There's a couple or a few different reasons why I would say no. Why do you say this isn't it?
The one that, you know, is the one that we're looking for, you know, that's with Israel and Iran and all the Arab nations coming together. This is a precursor to it because it gets two of the parties of the seven to come together.
Yeah, very well put. Yeah, that's a huge reason why I would say I would agree with you 100%. This is not the treaty, but it's definitely a step in that direction. Now, here's what's interesting is that the covenant of Daniel 9:27, one thing about that is that Jared Kushner just last week was saying, hey, I'm envisioning all 22 Arab nations signing peace treaties with Israel. So, boy, I mean, talk about just a major prophetic proclamation, right?
Yeah.
But the 22 Arab states he's talking about are the ones that the 22 states have formed the Arab League. Iran is not included in that.
Yeah, that's true.
Because it's not an Arab state.
You got Afghanistan. Who else is in that?
I don't know Syria. If Afghanistan's on that, but it's Syria, Lebanon, Saudi Arabia, Yemen, Oman, Morocco, Algeria. So it's all the essentially
ones that surround them, but Iran and Pakistan, I think, or Afghanistan.
The pertinent point here about Iran is that I don't think anyone's expecting Iran ever to sign a peace treaty, and Iran is actually who's going to back the Antichrist when he comes. So the treaty that's made in Daniel 9:27 does not include Iran. It will not include Iran. And Jared Kushner, when he's talking about these 22, that doesn't include Iran.
Right.
So pertinent, right? So the other thing is that the Daniel 9:27 treaty, we very much should expect that that's going to include as a major central component, the Jews will be allowed to rebuild their temple on the Temple Mount. Now, here's what's interesting. Here's what's interesting. There's so many interesting points here. And actually, it's time for another break, so let me make this real quick. These two treaties that were signed this week at the White House, Prime Minister Netanyahu was here from Israel, the leader from the UAE, the leader from Bahrain, right?
Yep.
Even this treaty, there are implications that it is direct. There's no question about it. It's directly related to the Trump Kushner Peace to Prosperity plan that was released in January. Mm-hmm. We'll talk about the ties. Actually, maybe next time I come in, because I want to look at a specific article from Al Jazeera of all things.
Okay.
But that plan, the Peace to Prosperity plan, we've talked about that before here on the show, very much pertains to the rebuilding of the Jewish temple. So even these two treaties that were signed this week, we see all these ramifications that have extraordinary end times implications.
Yeah.
It's a lot of syllables there, but there you go. Better take a break.
Yeah, we're going to go to some music, and we'll be back in just a few minutes from now. 800-721-9313, 800-721-9313. More with Pastor Ryan in the studio with me, talking about the coming kingdom, treaties, the rapture. Well,
Maybe. We'll get to that. Who knows?
There's all kinds of stuff. It's 10 minutes after. The phone number, 800-721-9313, 1-800-721-9313. Good morning, your Celebration Radio Network.
Good morning, sir. How are you today?
Good.
I was just listening to the morning show, and I would love to hear Ryan's take on the rapture.
Oh, boy. I would love to give it to you.
And where I'm coming from, brother,
is
from Matthew 24:29, where our Savior says, immediately after the rapture, these things will come after you know about...
Immediately after the tribulation, he says.
Yeah. And I would love to hear... I brought this topic up with my personal pastor, and big problem. So I would love to hear someone...
What's your name? I'm sorry.
I'm Evan Novoff up in Flagstaff.
Your name one more time? I'm sorry.
Evan?
Oh, Evan. Okay. Evan. Up in Flagstaff. And Evan, you're trying to get me in trouble, and I love it. I thank you for it.
No, I don't want to get you in trouble.
No, I'm joking.
I want to have an open conversation about what our Savior said.
And you know what? What you said is actually 100% my go-to scripture when it comes to the rapture, Matthew chapter 24, verses 29 through 31. So if Bill indulges me, we will... talk about that. It actually pertains precisely to what we're talking about Rosh Hashanah and Sukkot and all that. So,
yes.
So we'll
be blessed on these holidays, sir.
You
Thank
too.
You so much.
Appreciate the call. God bless. We'll talk.
God bless you.
Okay, take care.
I have Pastor Ryan Speakman in the studio with me this morning, and we've been talking about the coming kingdom. And we had another great call, question about the Matthew 24.
Yeah, the phones are actually kind of ringing off the hook this morning, which is cool. I like it this way.
Yeah,
people are listening. So
right.
Yeah.
And they have questions. And Evan's question from Flagstaff was really good. So we'll get to that in a minute. I've got a little bit of house cleaning to do before we get back into our discussion. But I just wanted to remind everybody that the Point of View Radio Talk Show special programming opportunity is tomorrow evening. It's Where is America Headed? Finding Hope in a Time of Fear.
Wow.
It's going to begin at 5:30 p.m. Pacific time, and it'll go until 7:30. It has Vice President Mike Pence going to be speaking, and Graham Lotz, Greg Laurie, Tony Evans, David Brody, and keynote presentation will be by Joel Rosenberg. So you'll want to stay tuned for that. It starts tomorrow evening at 5:30 p.m. on your Celebration Radio Network across the whole network. Now, this event is sponsored by a coalition of more than 30 churches in Rapid City, South Dakota, and it will be held in the Barnett Arena, which is a 7,000-seat facility in Rapid City. So I know that the event is not going to be about a political agenda or anything like it. It will be an evening focused on the spiritual condition and future of our nation.
Sounds
Speaking
awesome.
Of future of our nation.
Right.
You know, there are a lot of, I guess it's probably split maybe 50-50. The statistics might be off on that, so don't quote me, of people thinking that America is not in the Bible. I know this is off our topic.
Right.
But
it's actually right on our topic.
There is a key point in Daniel that people overlook, I think.
Yeah. Well, it's all throughout the book of Revelation, too. So,
yes.
So,
I wholeheartedly believe that
your statistics are completely off, and I have fun saying that because you're never wrong about anything.
I knew they would be.
But I'll tell you, no, I would say it's probably more like, 99% of people who, teachers, Christians who are into end times prophecy, believe that the United States of America plays any kind of a significant role in the end times story. And 99% say that we don't. So those who believe in a pre-tribulation rapture, for example, what they teach. So 85% of Christians worldwide don't even believe in end times. Let's start with that, right?
Yeah, they don't even believe in a rapture or
they don't. Yeah,
or
the whole end time
like that,
story.
Yeah.
So that eliminates 85% right there. The other 15% of us that believe in an end times, 96% strongly believe and teach what we call the pre-tribulation rapture, which is the idea that that the body of Christ will be taken out of this world before the 7-year Great Tribulation begins. This is right in line with Evan's question from Flagstaff.
Yes.
He called during the break. because he asked us to comment on what's our belief about the rapture, right? So, and I actually, I'll just come right out and say it. So I believe as much as I believe anything, I'm 100% convinced that the raptures, and this, my views do not necessarily reflect the views of this station or its management or staff. That's very important. I get that out there.
Yes.
But I very much believe in and teach, what I believe that Jesus, Paul, and John taught, which is a post tribulation rapture. I hope we don't lose half our listeners right there. Just hang in there with us. That the rapture is going to take place concurrent with Jesus' second coming and the resurrection of the righteous dead at the end of the 7-year Great Tribulation. So, and we'll actually look at some scripture briefly here, you know, because Evan asked us to about that.
Yeah, Matthew 24 lays it out pretty clearly, I think. Yeah.
I think so too.
Jesus is the one that's saying it. So,
well, this thing about America, so that means that the body of Christ will be here, including in America. Listen, America has a major role to play in the end time story.
Yeah.
You brought up the book of Daniel. You're exactly right. It's Daniel chapter 11 talks about the Antichrist when he goes to war in the Middle East and he you know overcomes Egypt and Jordan somehow manages to resist him and Ethiopia you know gives into him and Libya gives into him. And he basically, you know, takes over, you know, most of the Middle East, right? That he becomes very troubled because an invasion takes place from the West and the Hebrew word there's kitim, which literally means, please research it online, people, if you're interested in this, kitim, and it's usually translated Cyprus in our English translations, but this entity called kitim invades northern Israel and stages the War of Armageddon up in the Valley of Jezreel, or what we call the Plains of Megiddo. Mm-hmm. That means the hegemon from the West. That is none other than the United States of America. We are the end times hegemon. We're by far, not only are we the ruler of the world system, we're the most substantial global hegemon ever to exist in human history, and we will be the hegemon throughout the... Listen, we're mentioned in Revelation chapter 18. I'm not going to go into detail about how. There's some positive aspects.
There's talk of an eagle.
Some negative aspects. Yeah. Revelation chapter 12, that the Jews are taken into southern Jordan and protected. They're taken there on the wings of an eagle. And what's the symbol of America? An eagle.
Yeah.
And also in ancient literature, the eagle refers, eagle in that context, refers to the hegemon, whoever the dominant
powers of the time. That's why the Romans
the time.
Had that on all their staffs.
Yes,
the eagle's
exactly.
Head
the
whole upper body
of
the eagle was pretty substantial.
Right.
Even kings, you look throughout history, it's been on banners and it goes before the war and, before the armies.
Right.
And that's actually a really important royalty symbol,
Yeah, it's true. Yeah. That's actually a really important connection that you're making, because that's one of the reasons that the eagle is the, official symbol of the United States, is because our founding fathers considered this to be the final permutation of the Roman Empire.
Right.
So
all you gotta do is look at the layout of Washington D.C. and you can see
the architecture,
that.
Roman style. We're a Republican, republic form of government, which is a Roman style of government. You read the writings of the founding fathers, Hamilton and Jefferson,
everywhere.
Washington.
And they all
say outright, hey, we're trying to resurrect the Roman Empire. We're the final permutation of it. Hitler tried to do that too. He failed his own version of it. But the Book of Daniel also makes clear, even King Nebuchadnezzar's dream, I'm not going to get into all the details, but that final hegemon that is the leader of the world system, what's called Babylon, at the time that Jesus returns to earth, that Messiah comes, that it will be a permutation of the Roman Empire. So America's in the end time story. One, and the thing about the rapture again, there's all the Christians that are in America today, we're going to be here during that time. And this I believe is why there's that extreme righteous component that says we're not going to stand for the Antichrist invading, Israel, usurping the temple. And this is why the Bible says that we're going to invade Israel at that time, and we will be the main power, maybe the only power, that actually confronts and opposes the Antichrist.
Yeah.
So yay for America for that.
Yeah. And
there's some negative
Trump
aspects too, but.
And others that are standing with Israel now, moving the embassy to Jerusalem. I mean, all of the steps that he's taken so far, our president, are all leading to that point in time.
Very much so. Yeah, this is also unprecedented
the precursors to the treaty. I mean, with these treaties that he's been doing.
Yep.
And he says there's seven more big deals that are coming. So.
Yeah. So the big one to be watching for is Saudi Arabia.
Yeah.
When Saudi Arabia signs on, then what we're seeing is nothing less than the end times coalitions forming right before our very eyes. We're seeing it already. And what I mean by that is that the Bible is very clear, Old Testament and New, particularly the Old Testament, which nations will be involved in the end time story, who the belligerents will be, and who's going to be fighting against whom. And this is precisely what we're seeing happening right now.
Yeah.
So we're seeing, you know,
pretty amazing,
because Saudi, I mean, the UAE, Bahrain, you know, the rest of the Arabian Peninsula, what we call the Gulf states, every Sunni Muslim, nation in the Middle East. What's the main reason that they're all of a sudden signing these treaties with Israel and the United States? Because of Iran, because Iran's on the verge of getting nuclear weapons,
yeah.
Even with the steps that our president's taken to prevent that. And, so, you know, we're seeing this setup. There's going to be a major war. Iran's going to have nuclear weapons, and the Sunni Muslim nations are going to be, you know, actually fighting on the side of Israel during that time. In essence, it's all right in the Bible. So
yeah, it's pretty amazing.
We're seeing it happen. Amazing stuff. So, is it about time for another break?
We got to go to some music.
When we get back, I want to dive right into 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, and I will very briefly address this issue of the timing of the rapture, because it actually pertains to everything we're talking about this morning, and we'll talk about next time too, I'm sure, including and especially Rosh Hashanah, which starts tonight, and Yom Kippur and Sukkot. Okay, this all relates to each other.
Day of Atonement, and that's all coming up.
We're in that time of the year.
Just a couple of weeks away.
This is, just long story short, this is the time of the year when Jesus will return. I've been seeing on Facebook all this chatter the last couple of weeks that there's a lot of people right now, Bill, I don't know if you knew this. Yeah, I mentioned right it before, before we went on this morning, that think that the rapture is going to happen at sunset today. So there's like this whole like movement on Facebook right now, and, you know, probably other social media platforms, that a lot of people are thinking today is the rapture. It's going to happen today. I can assure you people, and if anyone wants to call in and bet money, I'm just kidding. We don't gamble here. We don't promote gambling. But I promise you the rapture is not going to happen today. However, I do believe it is going to happen at precisely this time of year, but in some future year. So let's take a break. We'll talk about that when we come back.
Matthew West with Truth Be Told coming up next on your Celebration Radio Network. The number 800-721-9313.
Line number one, you're supposed to have it all together. And when they ask how you're doing, just smile and tell them never better. Line number two, everybody's life is perfect except yours. So keep your messes and your wounds and your secrets safe with you behind closed doors. But truth be told, the truth is rarely told. I say I'm fine, yeah, I'm fine, oh, I'm fine, hey, I'm fine, but I'm not. I'm broken, and when it's out of control, I say it's under control, but it's not, and you know it. I don't know why it's so hard to admit it, when being honest is the only way to fix it. There's no failure, no fall, there's no sin you don't already know. So let the truth be told. There's a sign on the door, says come as you are, but I doubt it. Cause if we live like that was true, every Sunday morning pew would be crowded. But didn't you say church should look more like a hospital? A safe place for the sick, the sinner and the scarred and the prodigals like me. Well, truth be told, the truth is rarely told. Oh, am I the only one who says I'm fine? Yeah, I'm fine, oh, I'm fine, hey, I'm fine, but I'm not. I'm broken, and when it's out of control, I say it's
it's under control, but it's not, and you know it. I don't know why it's so hard to admit it, when being honest is the only way to fix it. There's no failure, no fall, there's no sin you don't already know. So let the truth be told. Can I really stand here unashamed, knowing that your love for me won't change? Oh God, if that's really true, then let the truth be told. I say I'm fine. Let the truth be told.
We'll help you stay focused on the things that matter.
I battle depression sometimes, and it uplifts me when I'm down. It helps you, you know, look through the depression and forward on to a brighter day.
Your celebration station.
Today, worship today. Came to us in grace and in truth, still with us, still on the move. The same Jesus, He's making us new. He's making us new. I know that my Redeemer lives.
Still keeping all His promises.
Yes, he will keep all of his promises. That is Matt Redman with The Same Jesus on your Celebration Radio Network. Well, Pastor Ryan is in the studio with me this morning. We were talking about, well, many things. The treaty that was just signed this week with the two countries in Israel, and President Trump holding that signing ceremony at the White House.
Yeah.
Which is pretty, like, just unheard of when you think about it, when it's the Middle East.
Oh, my gosh.
Peace treaties don't even usually come into a conversation when you talk about the Middle East,
well,
let alone...
Well, this has never even happened. So there's two, you know, existing peace treaties between Israel and its Muslim Arab neighbors, Egypt 1979 and Jordan 1994. But both of those treaties were to end a state of war.
Yeah.
These treaties this week, completely different. This
right.
has nothing to do with war. It's,
yeah, it's trade.
Hey, we want to be friends.
Yeah, we want to be friends.
We want to, you know. Yeah, we want to do business together. So,
yeah, exactly.
So very different kinds of treaties. Never seen this before.
Yeah.
Very prophetically significant.
Yes,
so.
Definitely. Now, we just had another call from Shauna. Unfortunately, you weren't able to be on the call. We had a phone glitch, but she just wanted to verify also that she does not believe that the rapture is happening tonight.
yeah.
You know, because it being Rosh Hashanah and all that's going on, you know, Jesus says after, you know, all of this in Matthew 24, you can, you know, well, why don't you were going to talk about that, Matthew 24, and but you were also going to go into, I think, 1 Thessalonians. Was it?
Yes. So we had a gentleman, not the last break, but
yeah.
The one, yeah, Evan from Flagstaff, call in and just ask us to, you know, clarify where we stand on the rapture. So I believe that that Bill and I are in agreement on the timing of the rapture. And again, and this does not, again, necessarily reflect the views of KNLB or Celebration Radio Network, but you know, this is, you know, Bill and I've talked quite a bit about this. I know we're in agreement on this, that that the rapture is actually going to take place not at the beginning or before the 7-year Great Tribulation, but afterward. And here's kind of the main reason why. So Evan brought up Matthew chapter 24, verses 29 through 31, which really I would consider the Bible's quintessential rapture passage. A lot of end times teachers would disagree with me on that. They would say, no, that passage has nothing to do with the rapture. And what they would point to instead is 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. I know, right?
Yeah.
Bill shaking his head. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So what I would point to instead, or what they would point to instead, is 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, which I see where they're coming from, because that's actually where we get the word rapture. So let me read this real quickly. This is Paul speaking,
yes.
Right, writing in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13. He says, "But I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep," or in other words, died, "lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus himself died and rose again, even so," in other words, physically resurrected,
mm-hmm.
"even so God will bring with him," with Jesus, "when he returns, those who sleep in Jesus." Now, how will he do that if they're dead in the ground here? Well, he's bringing their spirits with him, because their spirits, we know, are in heaven with Jesus, right? Verse 15, "For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain here on the earth until the coming of the Lord," the second coming, "will by no means precede those who are asleep." Okay, that means that the spirits that return will be rejoined with their resurrected physical bodies before where those of us who are alive and remain are raptured. The resurrection happens first, then the rapture. Verse 16, "For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with a trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first."
That's right.
That happens first. "Then we who are alive and remain," that'll be us, Bill, we're not mm-hmm. going to die, we're going to be raptured, amen?
Yes.
"Shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord." That phrase there, "caught up," is
rapizo, or
it's actually harpazo
in
the Greek.
That's
okay,
it. Yeah.
But in the 4th century, there was a very famous monk named Saint Jerome, who, working in a grotto underneath the Church of the Nativity in Bethlehem, I've been there. I've been in the grotto and everything. Penned what we know as the Latin Vulgate, and he translated the Bible from the original Hebrew and Greek into Latin. And in the Latin Vulgate, he translated harpazo, which again in English is caught up, to the Latin word rapiemur.
Rapiemur.
So the anglicized form of the Latin word is rapture.
Yeah.
So it's very, very simple. A lot of people say, oh, the rapture is not even in the Bible, the word rapture. It is. The word rapture is 100% in the Bible. It's the Latin version. Okay.
Yeah.
You got to go to the Latin. So now, here's the thing. A lot of end times teachers, including the biggest one, so I'm talking Hal Lindsey, Tim LaHaye, Grant Jeffrey, they would all point to 1 Thessalonians 4 and say, see, this proves a pre-tribulation rapture. Okay, here's my challenge. everyone listening, please go look at this whole passage, 1 Thessalonians 4, and tell me in what way it proves a pre-tribulation rapture. This passage does not mention the tribulation. It doesn't mention the Antichrist. It gives us 0 point of reference to use to be able to say the rapture happens at this point in relation to the tribulation,
anything
the
Antichrist.
Anything
that's going on in the world.
Because, yeah, Paul provides no point of reference here. So we cannot use 1 Thessalonians 4 to determine the timing of the rapture. It does describe the rapture. The reason that Paul didn't bother to include the timing is because Paul's quoting somebody else here. This is what everybody misses, okay? Not everybody. A lot of people miss this, a lot of teachers. All Paul is doing is he's reminding the Thessalonians, the Church of Thessalonica, of what they'd already been taught by, you ready for this? Jesus himself in the Gospels. So all Paul's doing is just referencing back to what Jesus himself taught in Matthew chapter 24. So why don't we take another quick break, should we? Or maybe talk about the contest real quick, and then we come back, we'll look at that. And
yeah, we'll look at that. Also, we're going to give you a chance to win part one and part two of These Final Days by Pastor Ryan Speakman. Also, a DVD series that's going to go along with that from your first trip to Israel back in, what,
2012. Yeah, that was my first trip. So it's very amateurish. Kind of lame, and you'll love it. It's cool stuff. It's actually pretty cool content.
Well, there's going to be some great video of the Holy Land of Israel.
Yeah, I even
the surrounding area. So
yep, I do interviews on that. I my first trip there, I visited Sderot right on the border with Gaza. I you know toured around, heard all about the rockets hitting Sderot, and saw the bomb shelters. And so there's some interesting stuff there. I went to the Mount of Transfiguration.
Oh, cool.
Where Jesus met with Moses and Elijah. Yeah. And that was when he like officially became Messiah. That's in accordance with Daniel chapter 9, verses 25 through 29, right?
Yeah.
I'm sorry, 24 through 27. But yeah, so, you know, good stuff. Anyways.
It's going to be fun to give that away, and we'll be doing that here in just a few minutes, so stay tuned. 800-721-9313, 1-800-721-9313. Well, it's 17 minutes to the top of the hour on your Celebration Radio Network. This is Bill and Pastor Ryan in the studio with me this morning, and I've got some really great things in front of me that we're going to be giving away. One of them is your DVD series from 2012, which has video of you making what? What are you doing?
The blue dye, the tequila.
Blue dye, yeah.
Which has been the topic of our shows for the last, you know, couple of shows at least. So, in fact, our last show that we did 3 weeks ago, I wasn't here last week, we actually ended with that, me describing going to this little town called Kfar Adumim, right outside of Jerusalem. It's actually in the West Bank, and visiting the Patil Tehelet factory. And I didn't know back then that one day I'd be directly involved with these guys and you know, working on this project to bring together, you know, one of their main scientists with this marine biologist in Australia. We talked about all this on our previous shows. Find our podcast, The Coming Kingdom with Bill and Ryan. You can listen to our past shows. But we've been kind of building up about this incense fundraiser I've been doing. By the way, we've officially hit the halfway mark. So I have about $3,300 raised so far of the $6,500 that we need to make this happen. But yeah, so 2012, I met these guys for the first time. I actually participated in making the blue dye. And I brought Bill a little show and tell thing this morning.
Brought in an actual piece of that thread that they weave into all of their clothing. I can't remember what they're called, those apron things that they wear around their necks.
The
really long scarf.
The tallit, yeah, tallitov.
Yeah, tallitov.
And the knots are tzitzit or tzitzit is the singular.
Yeah.
And those are their prayer shawls. And but more importantly, the tehelet is used in the high priest garment.
Yep.
The coverings over the Ark of the Covenant, the Table of Showbread, the golden incense. It's woven, this is God's commands, into the veil that separates the holy from the Holy of Holies. So the blue dye is very important. And the blue dye that I brought you to look at, Bill, we'll take a picture of it and put it on
KNOB's
website.
We'll
take a look.
Yep.
Because this is radio, not TV. You'll have to put it on. But that the blue dye, that's the real stuff you're seeing there right behind you. That's the real tehelet, the biblical stuff.
That's
disappeared
cool.
for 1,400 years. Now it's back. And that's the blue dye that I actually made when I was there. So they let me dye some string and keep it. And then there's a couple of sea snail shells in the shadow box. And that's Murex trunculus, which is the famous sea snail that the blue dye comes from. So
yeah.
So I've been promising to let you get a picture with that. We'll do it
after the
show today.
After the show. And get it up on Facebook and on the KNLB's Facebook. I'm going to share it to mine. And
remember, go to
on yours as well. So
for sure, go to thesefinaldays.org and just click on the link for the incense fundraiser to read about what we're doing. We never even finished that story. And then
we'll
get back around to it next time or whatever.
Stuff happens in the world we got to talk about. Peace treaties and all of that. And questions.
Rosh Hashanah is today.
Rosh Hashanah and questions from our... our listeners calling in. We've had probably 10 calls this morning. So, people are excited about what's going on.
This is why I love what God's called me to, which is end times prophecy, because it's the gift that keeps on giving.
There's
always new stuff. So back to the rapture.
Right. And then a contest.
Why don't you mention the contest first?
We have These Final Days, part one and two. It's the truth about the rapture, the four horsemen, and the prelude to the Great Tribulation is part one. And part two is how the Great Tribulation begins in the third temple and Jerusalem. Now, part three is very close to being published, and that is going to be on... What's the subtitle for that?
I don't remember my subtitle, but it's about the Antichrist, the rebuilt temple, and the fact that the Holy Spirit will actually return to the rebuilt temple.
Oh, awesome.
Yeah, okay. I mean, there's some amazing stuff in that. Yeah, part three.
That is coming soon.
It's my favorite of the whole series so far. Yeah, it's amazing.
And then we also have Israel, a final day's perspective. It's a two-disc set, and like Pastor Ryan was saying, he has video of him making the actual blue dye. So that's what's up for grabs this morning by calling 800-721-9313. In just a few moments, we'll be doing that. Good morning, your Celebration Radio Network.
Hi, Bill. This is Victoria from Chino Valley.
Hi, Victoria.
Hi. My voice is cracky because this is early for me to be up. I have a question. David Hawking from H-O-C-K-I-N-G. In Revelation 3:10, he said in the Greek language, it means to take us up. So I was just questioning that in Revelation 3:10.
Why don't you go over the scripture that Victoria was her question?
Oh, sure. Yeah. Matthew
24.
Yeah. So Victoria said that, you know, she listens to a end times teacher, and I forget the gentleman's name that she said, but he teaches, you know, pre-tribulation rapture. And she mentioned one of the verses that he uses to support that view. So it's Revelation chapter 3, verse 10. This is Jesus talking to one of the seven churches. And he says, Jesus says, because you have kept my commandments to persevere, or my command to persevere, I will also keep you from the hour of trial, which shall come upon the whole world to test those who dwell on the earth. So what I pointed out to Victoria is that the original Greek there, and I've studied it thoroughly. If you get an interlinear Bible, go look at it. Interlinear Greek Bible, right? Go look at the actual verbiage there. And the connotation is not, I will keep you from, but I will keep you through. Okay, very important distinction. I will keep you through the hour of trial. And also, hour, if you look up that word hour anywhere else in the book of Revelation, it literally means an hour or an extremely short period of time. So that really can't be interpreted to mean the entire 7-year period of tribulation. You know, and stuff like this really, and she was so sweet, very gracious. She said, oh, darn it. You know, it's like, we're going to have to go through the, but you know, things like that, those are arguments. And I don't mean that in a bad way. I mean, it's just kind of like, well, see this. This seems to imply this. You know, that would all be useful if we didn't have a clear cut, plain English language, you know, for us, our translation chronology laid out in scripture of where the rapture takes place in relation to the Great Tribulation and the time of the Antichrist. But you know what? Most teachers don't see this or teach it. We do have that. Jesus himself, tells us in very plain terms.
Before the crucifixion.
Yeah, it's before he went to the cross.
His resurrection.
Yeah.
It was before he went to the cross.
It was part of the Olivet Discourse.
Very close to him, you know, him going to the cross.
It was that week or whatever. It was like the day before, the evening before he got arrested and then ended up going to the cross. So it was his final sermon. Okay. It was his second longest recorded sermon. His last words, his last teaching to the disciples, which means by extension us, before he went to the cross. Exactly. Second longest, you know, sermon ever recorded after the Sermon on the Mount. And in that Jesus very plainly tells us when the rapture will take place in relation to the Great Tribulation, the reign of the Antichrist. And it actually relates again directly to the quintessential rapture passage, which we read before the last break, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Why don't we take another break real quick? We'll look at that passage in Matthew. Yep. And then,
So 800-721-9313, 800-721-9313. Well, congratulations to Patty from Sholo winning this morning from your Celebration Radio Network, and Pastor Ryan for donating the books and the DVD set. Really appreciate that. I know that listeners do as well.
My pleasure. Anyone who wants to read my books, I don't make it hard, so. Right.
So we're going to talk to her in just a moment. You were going to explain Matthew. Well, not maybe explain is the right word, but read Matthew 24. Well, I guess explain would be the right word, wouldn't it?
Well,
I
mean, we're going to tie it into the quintessential rapture passage, according to all the end times teachers, right? Which, again, is 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 16 and 17. There's two verses in particular I want to hone in on. So again, we read this before, but this is Paul talking, 1 Thessalonians, for the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, with the trumpet of God. The dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up. That's where we get the word rapture. It's from the Latin Vulgate, rapiemur, together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. Thus we shall always be with the Lord. Everybody agrees, everyone who believes in the rapture agrees that this passage I just read from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 describes the rapture. Now, check this out. Just in those two little verses, we've got a lot going on there. I'm going to point out five very important details that are very unusual, not common, and there's not one or two of them. There's five details, just these two verses. This account begins with Jesus appearing in the heavens, in the clouds. This is an unusual event, right? It's described as highly conspicuous, okay? In this case, it's a very loud event, okay? It's not quiet and secret. Number three, it depicts an accompaniment of angels. Number four, it includes mention of a trumpet in conjunction with the angels. Again, these are not like common details. This is weird stuff. Finally, number five, just in these two verses, it concludes with believers being gathered together to join Jesus in the air. So check this out. Okay, like I said before, Paul is simply quoting what Jesus himself had already taught.
Right.
This is the tie-in we don't get from most end times teachers. Matthew chapter 24, verses 30 through 31, some of Jesus' last words he spoke before he went to the cross. And this is his conclusion of the chronological portion of what we call the Olivet Discourse. And this is what Jesus says. Then Jesus himself says this. He says, then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in heaven. Then all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he will send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet, and they will gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other. So did you see that? Again, we only have two verses here, this time from Jesus himself, and we have the same five amazing details. It begins with Jesus appearing in the heavens. It describes a highly conspicuous event. In this case, it's widely visible. All the tribes of the earth will see him. Number three, it depicts an accompaniment of angels. Number four, it includes mention of a trumpet in conjunction with the angels. Finally, number five, it concludes with believers being gathered together to join Jesus in the air. Anyone who says that these two verses from Matthew are not describing the exact same event as the two verses in 1 Thessalonians 4, something's wrong. They're clearly describing the same event. And here's the clincher, ladies and gentlemen, and I'll end this point with this. Right before Jesus says this, I just read Matthew 24, verses 30 and 31. Verse 29, what comes before 30? 29. This is how Jesus starts this little narrative. He says, immediately after the tribulation of those days, the sun will be darkened, the moon will not give its light, the stars will fall from heaven, the powers of the heavens will be shaken. What is that again? It's Jesus said, immediately after the tribulation of those days.
Yeah.
Then he goes on to describe his second coming, the angels, the trumpet, and believers being gathered from one part of earth to the other part of earth. It's different, you know, verbiage in Mark 13, Luke 21. You know, and before Jesus says all this, he actually describes the abomination of desolation when the Antichrist takes over the temple. He says, anyone in Jerusalem, get out of Dodge. It's going to be, you know, he coins the term great tribulation in verse 21. He says, for then there will be great tribulation. This is the first time we see this term, such as has not been seen from the beginning of time, nor ever shall be, unless those days were shortened. No flesh shall be saved. Before the elect's sake, those days will be shortened. And then again, he says, at the end of all this, immediately after the tribulation, then I'm going to show up, then I'm going to gather my elect. Why do I believe in a post-tribulation rapture? Let me be bold, because Jesus himself clearly, plainly taught it. Paul backs him up on it. We see it in the book of Revelation. It's depicted in, you know, Revelation chapter 19. You know, it's pretty clear cut. I think. And that sounds like bad news. We're going to have to go through the Great Tribulation. Hey, God loves us. He's going to protect us. He supernaturally protects us. We're going to do great exploits, Daniel chapter 11 says. It's just, you know what? Jesus, when he comes back, he's looking for faith. Just be in faith, body of Christ. Just stay filled with faith. Trust
and
God.
And the Holy Spirit.
And we're learning it now, man, in this COVID-19 thing and all the other turmoil on the earth. The same way we're learning to live now, if we keep this during the Great Tribulation, we stay filled with the Holy Spirit, it's going to be an amazing time.
It is.
So I'm not afraid, and I encourage others, don't be afraid. Stay in faith.
Yeah.
But we were chosen. We're a chosen generation destined to represent our Lord and Savior like no other generation of Christians has ever had the opportunity to represent, to say strong and bold and courageous and faithful during the darkest times that are coming. And again, Daniel chapter 11 says, we will do great exploits. It's going to be a very, very exciting time.
It is.
So I say bring it on, man. I mean, gosh, the sooner we get this party started, the sooner Jesus is coming back. So let's do it. Let's get it done. Right?
Yes. Well, it's 13 and a half minutes after the hour on your Celebration Radio Network, and now I just want to say again, good Friday morning to you. Romans 12:21 is our YouVersion Bible app verse of the day that says, do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. How cool is that?
Yeah, I love it.
What a great verse for today.
Yeah.
And the hour that we live in with all the evil that is in this world. We can
a lot of tension out there.
And there is. And, you know, thankfully, all the hoarding of toilet paper and all of that stuff that a lot of people were making fun of, you know, on social media and thing. But people were physically getting hurt over stuff like that.
I know. It's crazy. Yeah.
You know, and now that we've come back to our senses, sort of, you know, at least trying this new normal. You know,
there's toilet paper back on the shelves.
Yeah,
long
there
story
is.
Short,
yeah, right? Yeah. Most of the shortages are done, but you still see blank shelves. I mean, they're like empty.
Yeah, and I think that's because a lot of the, you know, factories or food production that they closed down for so long because of the COVID. So you know, the supply
is
down.
It's hard to get those supplies back up to where they were normally.
Yeah, but it does. It makes people tense and angry and afraid.
Yeah.
And
be kind, you know?
Mm-hmm.
That's all I'm saying. Just be good and you can overcome evil.
And it's easy for us to be kind and loving and all that because we can be filled with the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
Just ask the Holy Spirit to dwell inside of us and it's his fruit.
Right.
Love, joy, peace, kindness, gentleness, patience, self-control, all that. Yeah. So
I just wanted to share that with you. I normally do the Bible verse and some devotions, but this morning it's been exciting talking with Pastor Ryan.
I don't even know what our topic was today.
So many topics today. Peace treaties, the Tekalid.
Mm-hmm.
Did I say it right again?
Nope, you said it wrong that time. Okay. You said it right before, so you still get credit.
Tekalid. Well, the blue dye. The blue dye that's behind me in a shadow box style frame. We've talked about that. We're going to post a picture of us holding that on Facebook pages, so you'll be able to see it. And you also have like the widow's mite, and you know, there's snail shell. You know, the skeletons. You could say, I guess it's their shells.
But, the shells of
the actual sea snail,
famous snail we love so much. Yeah. And you're going to remember this eventually, Bill. It's called Murex trunculus.
Yeah, Murex trunculus.
You sound so smart when you say it. You know, you said that one right. So
Well, that I can get for some reason. I have a problem with that.
Yeah, it's that,
you know, that
sound. Yeah, back.
Yeah, I can't do that. So.
it took me a while.
So Rosh Hashanah starts tonight. So why don't you finish up talking?
Yeah. So
this
is our last segment for today.
What the holidays that are coming up for the Jewish nation?
Yeah.
Rosh Hashanah is incredibly important.
Yeah.
There's also the 10 day. Is it 10 days or 10 Aws?
It's the ten days of awe.
10 days
follow
of awe.
Rosh Hashanah.
And then we get into Sukkot.
Yes, there's another holiday, holy day, so to speak, before
the Day of
Sukkot.
Atonement.
The Day of Atonement, exactly. Yeah. You got it. So and all this stuff is so pertinent. I mean, you know, listeners might wonder, hey, is this just, information? And are these just guys just trying to sound smart or something? We are smart. We don't just sound smart, right?
Back if you say
here.
So.
Okay. I need some help here. So, but... But no, this is God's calendar. God is the one who ordained all of these holy days and festivals in yes. His word, in the Torah. He conveyed all this to Moses on Mount Sinai. And this is actually how we track God's timeline in terms of prophetic events. And most end times teachers do go along with that concept, right? So today is Rosh Hashanah. That begins today at sunset. Again, that's the beginning of the Jewish civil year, when all major contracts, treaties, and covenants are enacted. So we had a couple of really important ones take place this week. And we're looking for that ultimate one, the one from Daniel 9:27, which actually the Archangel Gabriel explained this to Daniel, that covers a period of 7 years.
Yeah.
Okay, that's a slight overgeneralization. It's 7 prophetic years. It gets a little bit complicated, but it's a 7-year treaty. And if we read on in Daniel, we see clearly that 7-year treaty takes place in the context of something else that covers 7 years, which is what we call the Great Tribulation.
Yeah.
Okay. So in other words, when that 7-year treaty, the future one that's coming, this one this week is kind of a prelude toward it, right?
Yeah.
But when that one comes, so what I'm wondering, kind of an interesting thought, is will that 7-year treaty begin on Rosh Hashanah of some future year?
Oh, okay? Good point.
And if that's true, then that means that the Great Tribulation must start sometime around Rosh Hashanah, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, now track with me here. So here's how it works. Rosh Hashanah takes place at the new moon. It's the first day. It's when you look up in the sky and there's no moon. Okay, that's what we call the new moon. Okay, it's when the first little tiny sliver appears. Right, but begins the whatever month. Okay, on the Jewish calendar. In this case, it's the month of Tishri, which many scholars believe is when Jesus was born. So I believe that Jesus was actually born on Sukkot in the year 2 BC, and he will come back to earth on Sukkot in some future year, okay? Now, here's the thing. When does Jesus come back in relation to the 7-year Great Tribulation?
After.
At the very end, yeah. Right? Or immediately after, at the very end.
Because so he says after.
Yes, after. Yes, that's immediately after. Immediately
yep.
after.
Yep.
That's Matthew 24:29. So if that's true, then that means that the 7-year Great Tribulation concludes on Sukkot, okay, approximately, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I would say precisely. But if how long is the Great Tribulation? It's exactly 7 years. That means that if it ends on a particular date, it must begin on that date too. You
right, yeah, me? 7 right? years.
So the Great Tribulation must begin on or around Sukkot of some future year. So if Rosh Hashanah, if the Great Tribulation, if that covenant, that 7-year peace treaty coincides with the 7-year Great Tribulation, and that 7-year treaty is enacted on Rosh Hashanah better be really close on the calendar to Sukkot. And it is. Okay, so how it works is we have Rosh Hashanah today, and that begins the 10 days of Awe, which is where the Jews kind of like reflect on the year and how have I done in terms of sin and being righteous. And then those 10 days conclude 10 days from now with what's called Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement.
Yeah, the Day of Atonement. Yeah.
Solemn day on the calendar for the Jews, right?
Yeah.
We don't need that because, we're atoned for once and for all with the blood of Jesus. They will be too one day when all the Jews en masse step into the new covenant. That's followed about 4 or 5 days later by Sukkot, which is the first full moon of the fall, right? It's called the autumnal equinox, right? So all this happens at exactly the right time. Okay, the timing of this that 7-year peace treaty will probably go into effect on Rosh Hashanah of some future year. That coincides with what will probably be the precise beginning of the 7-year Great Tribulation, Sukkot, and you know this, and then of course the Great Tribulation will end 7 years later on Sukkot with the return of Jesus. Now the reason we think that, and I've got to conclude with this. I see that we're going a little bit long here. That because the 3 main festivals, the Shalosh Regalim, they're called in Hebrew, Passover, Pentecost, and Sukkot, or in the Hebrew, Pesach, Shavuot, and Sukkot, the 2 spring feasts were fulfilled with Jesus' first coming.
Mm-hmm.
Passover was when he was crucified, major event, right?
Yeah.
And Shavuot is what we call Pentecost. That's the day that the Holy Spirit came 50 days later. Again, the 2 most important events from Jesus' first coming. But nothing has happened with Sukkot because that's the 1 fall festival that pertains to the harvest. It's the feast of ingathering. What was the word that we just saw that Jesus used to describe the rapture in Matthew 24, verse 31? He will send his angels. They will gather together his elect. The feast of ingathering. You see? See? Yeah. Feast of harvest. Exactly.
Yeah.
So all of it just goes together so beautifully, so perfectly. So no one knows the day or the hour, but I'm saying we know from God's word that we can't say the year, so we can't say the precise date. We certainly can't say the hour, but we can say, I think with confidence, that in some future year that the Great Tribulation will begin on Sukkot, okay, or in this time frame, right, this 2-week period. And that gets tricky with the math. We'll have to talk about that next time.
Yeah, because the Jewish calendar is shorter than the Roman calendar.
It doesn't precisely line up. The Hebrew calendar is based on a lunar cycle. The Gregorian calendar is based on solar cycle. And it takes 19 years for the two calendars to actually
meet,
line up. It's a 19-year metonic cycle, it's called, right?
Yeah.
And so it all gets very complicated. Also, the 7 years, it's actually not years of 365 days. It's each year equals 360 days. It's called a prophetic year. Yeah. So the math gets complicated. But long story short, this is the time of year when the Great Tribulation will begin, not this year, some probably near future year. And this is the time of year when Jesus will return. Very exciting. I think we should talk a little bit more about this because there's some crazy additional details about all this. Because next time we get together is in 2 weeks. And guess what day that is?
That's Sukkot.
That is Sukkot.
Yeah.
It's our next show is on Sukkot. So perfect reason to talk some more about this. And we're going to get into meteor showers and cosmic impact events. And seriously.
Yeah, it's going to be good stuff.
If you thought
good
today stuff. Was exciting, just tune in 2 weeks, right? Yeah,
amen to that. Well, I again want to say thank you for being here today, Pastor Ryan. Now, you are the associate pastor of Living Word Family Church.
One of the associate pastors.
Yeah.
Yep.
And we just love you guys, and we're very thankful for not only you, but and your wife, obviously, and Skylar, your daughter, but of your church and their support of the ministry over the years. And
we all love you guys
Pastor
so much.
Marine and Pastor Ted and, you know, the whole gang. So we're really, really thankful for all of you.
And Elijah, one of our kids.
Elijah, one of our going off best to DCU employees. Now and, he's going to, you know, Grand Canyon University. So moving on to newer things. So
yeah, and if I could give a shout out to my pastor, Pastor Maureen Collins. You just mentioned her, but she's the head pastor at Living Word Family Church, where I serve as one of the associate pastors. Yeah. And I just love her so much and appreciate her letting me do what I do, and you guys let me do what I do. And please, listening audience, this is good ground to sow into your Celebration Radio Network. So please support this radio station. You can go to knlb.com. How else can they donate to the station, Bill?
Just go to knlb.com, and there's a link there where it says donate now, and it'll take you to a secure website. So
yeah, and when you support this radio network, you're helping to support shows like this, assuming you enjoyed our show and all the other great content and music that
Treehouse One.
Focus, Celebrate,
Insight,
Recovery,
Touch, and, Celebrate Recovery and Recovery Radio, and
great team. The so light penetrating the darkness. So sow into this ground, please.
Well, we appreciate that. And you, 800-721-9313 for that prayer request, 800-721-9313.